rising sun, so we can go out to play in the water. Flowers will lay before we jump out of bed and go on our way. We get down on our knees and pray in the water. Flowers will lay. Come, 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 come on now.
Lift me, lift me up tonight. Take away my fears, make me feel alright.
This is ALIKA ATAY, and many of you know him because ALIKA is one of the small handful, five, I guess, of people that stood up and formed and said, I want to make a stand. That was, they called it the Shaka movement, but it was, well, you can tell us what it is all about. ALIKA is running for Maui County Council. No matter where you are on all three islands, if you like ALIKA ATAY, you can vote for him. Remember that. We have districts, but right now, until we have a district voting, if that becomes, we will vote for everyone. So he's your representative no matter where you are.
Right.
And that's a real winning thing to remember and important for us to do right at the front.
Great.
All right? Welcome to our show.
Hello. Hello. Thank you for having me.
It's a pleasure. Anything that is specially, I mean, obviously you don't run for only one reason. What other things, anything special that you'd like to do?
Well, I think first you mentioned, I guess the exposure or increased exposure of myself being involved with what you call the Shaka. And everybody throw the word Shaka out, but I wanna emphasize that the Shaka is just an acronym for what the meaning of sustainable Hawaiian agriculture for the Keiki and the Aina.
Wow.
And so that's, you know, my involvement has been, just like your agency, addressing the issues of sustainable Hawaiian agriculture for the Keiki and the future of our health of our Aina. That's what I stood for. And so with that, it was a period in my life where I said, you know, enough already. You know, we cannot allow these people to continue to be poisoning our land. And, you know, a lot of people are unaware that our drinking water source or our water aquifer is located just under our coral reef where a basal lens. So we're pretty much right near zero elevation. And you look at some of these agricultural chemical fields that they're at, they're sitting at like 40 feet, 50 feet. My involvement, why I raised my hand to say enough already and lead this charge, goes back 40 years. 40 years earlier, we've had the pineapple agrochemical companies that sprayed chemical poisons such as DDT, and this is out in the Haiku area in the Hamakualoa well, and that sits at like 300 something feet. You know, the poison went onto the plant, seeped through the soil, went into our water aquifer, and at a well that's located below 300 feet, 40 years ago, was deemed tainted and not healthy for us to consume and drink. Fast forward 40 years today, that same well is still tainted and deemed unhealthy for us. So if I encourage people to use hindsight and look at the past mistakes and learn from the past mistakes and also realize that we live on an island. We live on an island with very finite resources. Finite resources to the point of we gotta pay attention to our drinking water. And so we no longer can close our eyes and allow this chemical poisoning of our land. You know, you spray, conventional farming, they normally spray anywhere from 10 days to once every 10 days to once every 13 days. They'll spray a field with that. But in this genetic engineering method, they spray five times a day, every day, you know? And so with the drenching of the plants, seeping into our soil, sitting at a 40-foot elevation above sea level. It's not a question of if. It's a question of when. And when will that seep through and get an effect?
What are the chances of us seeing that stopped?
Well,
50-50. Either we will or we won't, right?
Yeah.
So that means that's what we know. If you stand up, then we will. If you don't stand up and make yourself counted, then we won't.
Yeah.
Isn't that the choice that we're talking? Yeah. That's how you really are involved, because
I got personally involved because I seen the storm. I seen the heavy rains. You know, there's a tropical storm that came onto the fields. Their fields got flooded with all these chemicals saturated. The saturated fields then funneled into our streams. And then I saw the streams going downstream into our ocean, carrying along these chemicals into our ocean. And I saw the effects of our bay. You know, I saw it. And
are you a farmer?
Yes.
Besides everything else that you've seen, you know from personal experience, there's another way.
There is another way. There's another way of producing a healthier product in a healthy way.
Do you think that the land that we live on, that you can make money on land with agriculture?
Yes. Let me ask you this. What do you do every day?
You mean eat?
Eat. Right? We eat food. Who grows the food? The farmer. Whether a farmer is in Hawaii or a farmer is in California, somebody's growing the food, right? Let's assume it's a farmer in California that's making all the money. Why are you sitting in Hawaii saying you cannot farm and cannot make money when there's a farmer sitting in California making money? So I don't see how that's connected. You know, we as a state have not committed to the production of food in our islands. Our current Department of Agriculture budget is only 0.04 of one, not even a 0.5% of the entire state budget. That's their commitment to agriculture. And of that commitment to agriculture, they have committed in the past to sugar and pineapple and now biotech. You know, where's the commitment to the production of food to feed the people? We have evolved to a state where we now consume 90% of the food that we eat is not from here. It's being
imported. Can you imagine that? I mean, look at this. We turned the camera so we'd have something beautiful behind us. Beautiful mango tree, all kinds of... This is a wealth of property. Papayas, there's squash around, there's all kinds of things to eat. Absolutely. Self-sustainability, if nothing else, can happen here.
Right. It can be done. I strongly, and so my excitement is this opportunity that's just around the corner. We hear about 36,000 acres of sugarcane fields that will now have, I don't know what the decision making is going to be, but I'm excited with the real opportunity for people to grow food to feed this island. You know, we need to, even if we committed to lowering our island imports from 90% to 80%, that 10% drop means $300 million into our economic activity.
You like those numbers? $300 million for 10% of our food supply?
Right.
What? Then that's only 10%.
Right.
That's also important to realize.
Yeah.
And what's the power and importance of self-sustainability? That is priceless. It's like that commercial. That is what's most priceless. We have a little moat around us called 3,000 miles of ocean. We have a place that could be completely, it is paradise. What are we doing to it? And also, you talked about something for the people. What's real close to my heart is affordable housing. Mm-hmm. I'm just beyond a doubt. Mm-hmm. How can you fall behind, know you're falling behind on housing, and then fall further behind and further behind, and now you're 10,000 units behind? Maybe it's 8,000.
Right.
Sure.
Well, there are solutions now to solve this problem in such a hurry. If you could put up refugees in or out of a country with and put up a city in no time, why can't we do something here?
That's the lesson that I've learned in my involvement in the last 2 years with this with this charge of this first, from going back to this People's Initiative ballot and the victory that we acquired from that.
Yeah.
And I learned that whole process, and the biggest lesson I learned is about power. There's corporate power, and then there's people power. There's organized money, and then there's organized people. And I strongly believe that organizing people, letting the people acquire their power, and representing themselves for the change that they want to see, that's why we're standing up. You know, we're saying, no, that's not what we want to see. What is just as important to know what we want to see and where we want to go, what is just as important is to know what we don't want. And so the people are saying, no, we don't want that. We don't want Maui to shift that way. We want Maui to keep Maui's values, to keep Maui's quality of life, and yet, maintain a better future for Maui, keeping that values and the mentality of Maui no ko'oe, Maui the best.
Think we can handle the affordability problem before we're swimming and people?
Well, that's one of my concerns that I have. You know, just like you, for the last two decades. I've heard 20 years worth of, I'm going to address affordable housing. And affordable housing today has brought us to a definition of 450,000 to 500,000. That's affordable. That is not. So my concern is, let's really address the truly affordable housing. Let's truly address the issue of displacement of our young local Maui families. And not, I hate to see them being displaced and having to choose to move away to the mainland, such as places as Las Vegas, because the quality of life is changed because the lack of availability of affordable housing. And so we need a truly affordable housing plan
now
that addresses steps. We need affordable rentals, we need affordable starter homes, and then we need them to go up, as well as affordable housing or rental housing for our senior citizens. You know, we have an expanding senior citizen amount, and we need to plan ahead for that. And I don't see too many senior housing in the horizon, but we do need that.
Do you think that you can do more on council than you can not on council?
I think either way. I mean, I live here, and as I shared with a lot of folks, the reason why I'm standing up is there is a difference with people who live here and people who come here just to sleep here.
Yeah.
There's a lot of people that come here because of jobs, and when I approach them and ask them, well, where is your home? Oh, back in Illinois or back in California, So that mentality tells me that they are not committed to living here. And there's some of us that say, we live here. And if you live here, this is your home. And if this is your home, then you will protect your home. To protect your home, to keep the health and welfare of your community to be safe, is why we want to be here. We're concerned about the health of our home. you know? And so, yes, can I be effective in office or out of office? I'm confident either way. The people must realize that their power is carried out through that vote. And primary election day on Maui is August 13.
Coming up.
We've already just passed the deadline to register to vote. So if you have not done so, that's okay. Because for the first time, first year, first election ever, we now have the opportunity to do same day voting.
Isn't that extraordinary?
From August 1st through August 11th. If you have not registered to vote and still want to participate in this upcoming primary elections vote, you can go to the county building between August 1st and August 11th, go in there, ask to register to vote, and the same day they will give you the card to vote. So it's not too late to be involved. The most important thing is to be involved. I've worked with the youth of Maui for some 35 plus years. So many of them are parents, and you know, my younger days, I used to always ask the kids, oh, who's your mom? Who's your dad? Trying to find connection. Nowadays, I see the kids and I gotta ask, who's your grandma? Who's your grandpa? And we still find connection, you know, but no matter what, I think it was through the youth and shaping the youth to live here, to continue to be proud of where they live. And now they all also carry that kuleana. They also carry that responsibility. You know, I always share with a lot of people that we all have one main goal in life. And that goal is to become a great ancestor. You know, anything we do, you try to be the best that you can be, and to be recognized as being a great ancestor. You don't want generations behind you, seven generations behind you, to look back at you and your generation and say, ah, they were.
They had a choice.
Yeah. So every one of us have that challenge to stand up and live life to its fullest, but also live that challenge to be a great ancestor.
Let me ask you, because I think our voters will want to know, if you would say, what is the difference between you and the other candidates and why they should, you know, what things that you want to stress make you a unique candidate for the job?
Well, most definitely. I compare, well, I'm up against four other candidates.
Right.
And we all live here. One is definitely, you know, it's the Aloha Aina values that I strongly believe. And I don't just say, throw it out as words, you know. It's you have to live it. You know, it's one thing to talk about Aloha Aina. It's another thing that we got to live that Aloha Aina. And Aloha Aina is the depth of understanding what that is. It is Aloha. It is love. Love for this land, love for Mother Earth, and love for the ocean. And people can say, oh, that's an environmentalist. No, you must see the connection of now you transcends to that love and relationship with humans and our people. And you got to protect the health and the welfare of our people. As an elected official, it's just like being an ali'i of the past. And the kuleana, or that responsibility of the ali'i, is always to the health and welfare of the people. Most importantly, they always look at the children, the keiki, and then the kupuna, the health of the senior citizens. So unlike the past, it's the same. You know, whether you're an ali'i or an elective official, you still have the same responsibilities to make the best decisions for the health and welfare of your community and people. So my difference in the others that's running is that, you know, I look back and I say, where were they? Where were they when the GMO poisoning was going on. Were they front and center standing up to protect the people? Were they front and center to save our land, to save our drinking? Our drink, I gotta emphasize this, our drinking water is a finite resource that we must always protect. Because without water, we will not have life.
End of game.
Yes. This year of all the years, I think for Maui County Council, I think if you as a citizen of Maui County feel that we the people have not been fully represented, this is the year. You know, I'm very excited because, you know, we have candidates running from Hana, from Haiku, from Upcountry, from South Maui. These are all like-minded Aloha Aina candidates that all care for the land that they live on. And the majority vote, if we can see nine of these candidates, out of these nine candidates that's filed, if five of these like-minded candidates get through, that's the majority vote. When was the last time that Aloha Aina, people who care for Maui and people who care for the people of Maui, would have the majority control? I cannot remember that. You know, of that, of the people, the nine people, there are seven Keikioka Aina, seven Hawaiians that are born and raised right here on this island that are also running. We're excited that we cannot even remember, but the potential of five of those seven individuals getting through and sitting on a county council seat brings us the first time ever that we can think of that county council decision making will be made by Keikioka Aina, those who are born and raised from this land.
That's huge. It sounds like Trump. That's huge. ALIKA ATAY, a very important candidate, Maui County Council, Wailuku Waihee Waikapu District, but you vote no matter which island. And if you see this video online or on Akaku or someone emails it to you, if you like ALIKA, you can vote for him no matter which of the three.
Yeah, teams. I think a lot of people are confused about, Wailuku District. And so I want to encourage everyone that if you live in Maui County, you are able to vote for me. And so if you're away, you're on the mainland and you're seeing this and you have relatives that live on Maui, Molokai and Lanai, please encourage them to cast their vote for myself, ALIKA ATAY, and the rest of the Aloha Aina folks.
And you can show them this video. Send it to them. Send them a link. Thank you for joining me. Is there anything that you can think of that I'm not bringing up that you'd like to bring up? Because I don't want to cut you off or take an issue that you want to talk about.
Yeah, well, I think there is an important part that a lot of people know of me because of my involvement with the Sustainable Hawaiian Agriculture, Keiki, and the Aina push, which is the Shaka movement.
Yes.
And they think that, that's the anti-GMO guy. And I do want to emphasize that, yes, I got involved in that arena. But many, many years of community service. I've been a community servant leader in the community in many facets. And I am confident that I am prepared and I am capable with creative thinking, critical thinking. I am capable and able to reach effective decision making on all topics. You know, I sit around and I look at the issues of affordable housing, I look at the issues of transportation, we look at the issues and representation of tourism and the role that they play, small business issues. So I want to emphasize that I'm not just in a box.
You're not one-dimensional.
Right.
You know, very important. Yeah. That's why I said he becomes a celebrity. You forget he's more than just a pretty face. He's got a lot of substance in a lot of areas.
you know, my biggest push right now is agriculture. I strongly believe that Maui's future opportunities other than tourism is agriculture. We did not invest in the production of food. So I'm looking and excited with this opportunity of creating green-collared economy. So in other words, all the green jobs, not just for the farmers, but there's also value-added businesses that can come. So I try to encourage people, the mentality has to change. You're no longer a tomato farmer. You are now a salsa farmer. You're no longer a basil farmer. You're now a pesto farmer. So that they can see.
And you can take your product to the end and make the big money.
Right.
Instead of just the money that when you sell it at the door, and then that guy makes all the money.
Yeah, so it's a matter of the economy. You know, it's a new green economy that we must embrace. And with this opening up of land, and it's not only the recent Alexander and Baldwin land that's open. If you look, Wailuku Sugar Land has been opened, Maui Land and Pine Land on the west side has been opened. All the land underneath the L in Lahaina, that's Kamehameha Schools Bishop Estate land, that's 4,500 acres. The Pioneer Mill land, all of these lands were never available. Now we have land and water available for the commitment of production of food. So we need to really look at that opportunity that's coming for us. What are we importing? Of what we're importing, what can we grow?
Yeah. You know? It was 20 years ago, more than 20 years ago, I heard Richard Cameron, not Colin's son, Richard, but the other Richard Cameron from HCNS, say in a meeting that at that time, 5,000 acres and they could grow all the food that's needed on the island. But it wasn't enough because they had 35,000, and so they didn't give it a hoot.
Right.
We give a hoot. Look where we are now because we don't give a hoot. Outrageous. It's within reason. It's within reach. All these things that people say are dreams and unreachable, don't limit yourself or us because you can't dream it. Because anything that you can dream, you can do. I mean, there's no question that there's so much land here. I've talked to one farmer, except he was living in Kihei, and I said to him, how much land do I need to feed your family? 10 feet by 20 feet, he could grow enough. He had too much. He was going and donating his stuff down at the market and selling it. We can be self-sustainable. Even if it's pots on your condominium.
Right, right.
There are solutions here. I'm just bringing it up because it's just, I hear it all the time. Oh, that's not realistic. You're asking too much. Mm-hmm. It's a matter of what you want in your life.
Yeah.
That's what you're asking. What kind of life do you want? Is it time for you to stand up and be accounted for and help make a difference in our world? Anyway, I sound like I'm standing on my soapbox.
No. I'm right there. I'm right there. In fact, I know the studies have been there, and an average household of five, a family of five, can survive off of half an acre. The theory in that is that if you planted 12 1,000 square foot food plots, that's like just about 15 foot diameter.
Yes.
If you had 12 and you harvest from that once a month and you keep on rotating it. So basically, you only need 12,000 square feet for food production. And then you need the size of your house. So how much square footage is that? So let's say it's 7,000 feet. So you add that 12. So you really need 19,000. And if you want to raise a small animal, let's add more space. So what it comes down to is that people can survive and live and feed themselves if they're willing to invest their time to grow their own food on half an acre, you know, to feed a family of five.
You know? And if you don't have time, I wouldn't be surprised if your neighbor and you can make out a deal.
Yeah, you make a barter.
See, the word barter sounds like the old days, but you know, every bank is barter. We choose these papers and we give them a value. Could be anything. think of all this land that you watch these big companies break off a little piece and change the zoning so they can sell it high and keep it in low ag. Yeah. And then they break off a little piece.
Yeah.
And when are you getting tired of that?
Right.
Remember it was 20 years ago or more that Mark Hodges talked about buying A and B?
Right.
And it's a little later, but still good idea.
Right.
And the people that are at A&B and HCS can make, HCNS and others, can make good decisions with us. There won't be an enemy because we can all work together. Someone that's trying to destroy, you know, will get weeded out. You know, I don't even want to use the word Monsanto because it becomes a stilted issue when you talk specifics, but everyone here is looking for this to save our island and save our world. Never in our history have we had days like we have now. And we have an opportunity in a unique place called Maui.
Yes.
Which, how wonderful is our home to make a difference. So, ALIKA ATAY, I'm off on a subject again. ALIKA ATAY, Maui County Council, all three islands. Thank you.
Thank you. Hello.
Pleasure.
Hello.
I know you'll tell me I talk too much. So be it.
Hello.
I think
that having that opportunity to know that, you know, a lot of people think, oh, that's the GMO guy. I was never involved in that until, you know, I got that phone call that to say, you know, we need your help, want to ask, you know, and I knew what my answer was going to be, but they took several minutes trying to convince me to join them and to be one of the citizens. And But inside, from the very beginning, I knew what my responsibility was, is to, you know, protect our home. And so be it. You know, that's how it became. And
you stood for the very brave Hawaiian brothers that know that they would like to stand too.
Yeah, and in fact, there were two others on the call that are also Hawaiians. And then the second day they said, oh, by the way, to be able to sign this citizens initiative, you need to be a registered voter. Well, those two other guys stepped back. Well, I haven't voted in 30 years. I'm not registered. So I guess I earned that seat by absence. You know, these other two guys stepped back.
That's one of my jokes I tell people. I was in a line of 1,000 men and women, and the general said, I need 10 brave volunteers. You may all die, but you're going to save this 1,000. And suddenly I heard this whooshing sound. And what was it? Everyone had moved back, and now I'm the leader.
That's
how leadership sometimes happens. Yeah. You know? But
yeah, that's exactly what happened.
It's a whooshing sound.
Yeah, yeah.
But I'm glad that I'm where I am. I just wish that get more leaders. We will.
Yeah, I think this awakening, you know, the victory of that initiative ballot was an important statement to a lot of people. And the statement was, we need to be at the table or else we will be on their menu. Yeah. And so with that, it encouraged more civic engagement, more individual involvement from people that you never expected, because they now see the big picture of their responsibility for the planet and their investment to our future. Our tutu used to say, what do you get when you do nothing? You're going to get nothing. So how will you change things for the better if you don't participate in that change? So I'm excited to look for what this, and that's why I'm kind of running too. You know, it's kind of like the tutus used to always say, hey, you gotta finish what you started. And what we started, yes, we were victorious in that initiative ballot, But that wasn't the end. That wasn't the end. That night when they announced we won the initiative ballot, we were all celebrating and hugging, and there was an elder couple, about two aunties, you know, like 82, 84, and they came up and hugged me and they said, you know, we never voted for 40 years, you know, and they were 82. And I said, why have you never voted? And they said, there was never anything worth voting for as to now. And then the next couple I saw were young couple, 32, 35. And they came up to me and hugged me and said, this was their first time ever voting.
Wow. And 32.
32, 35.
That blows my mind.
And I said, wow, you could have voted from when you were 18. And he goes, but it never mattered. It never mattered until now. So those two conversations that I had almost 2 years ago made me realize that my involvement was not about the GMO. I also thought it was about the pesticides and the chemicals, but it wasn't even about that. It was empowering the people to come alive, to participate in the process of voting. And so, you know, it made me reflect on a conversation that I had with my son before, and he said, why is it that the Hawaiian people don't participate in the election process? And I had a discussion with him, and I shared with him. He says, well, you try to be oppressed, not for one generation, not for two generations, not for three generations, but try be oppressed for maybe almost four generations. Wouldn't you acquire an attitude of apathy and not caring and not participating? And he said, yeah, but don't the people know and realize that they can be the ones to make the difference? They can be the ones to step up to the table and participate in voting?
You hear that, Mr. 18-year-old?
And
it's true.
And so that
to me is also important. These young kids that are going to wait till they're 35, isn't this powerful time?
Yeah, so that was 2 years ago.
Wow.
And why I'm running for office now, it was just a message that to me, it was, yes, we were victorious that night, irregardless about all the court details and where we are. We're in it to the fight. I visualize that court case will go all the way to the Supreme Court. You know, whatever the decisions of the Ninth Circuit Court judges are, whoever loses will challenge, will appeal. And that appeal will take us to Supreme Court. That's a separate issue. Where we are today is we need to encourage all of our residents to be at the table, to participate, exercise their power. And on August 13th, they have the power.
You have the power, August 13th. Remember again, I'm just going to remind you,
yeah.
August 1st to August 11th, you can go to the county clerk in the county building and register and same day vote.
Right.
And thank you for a young representative who was champion on that.
Kaniele Ng was the one that championed that process to allow us same day voting. So
yeah.
It's not too late. If you miss the deadline to register to vote, you can still exercise that power.
That's really good.
You know, and really be a part of this. So I hope your folks that are watching this program catch, you know, understand their role, their commitment, their responsibility of their role.
So when you're done listening to this, if it's on TV, smile and tell a friend that you saw it there. Go find it on the net and send it to five friends. That's what you do.
Yeah, for me.
And then vote.
Yeah, for me, we have that vision. You know, we have, you know, visit my website, you know, alikaatay.com. And I welcome you to visit our website. We have that vision. To see this vision to come forward, I say, it takes 2020. And 2020 is, it takes $20 donating and 20 votes. And if you can go around and get people to say 2020, donate $20 to your favorite candidate, encourage 20 different people to go and vote.
It's very funny because I used 2020 in this, that 20 years ago, we were ahead of our time. Now we have 2020 vision on what we should have done.
Right.
But you're right, 2020. And remember, this means you. It means you can vote. Thank you for joining us again. I didn't know I'd have this extra, but so be it. Maybe it'll be two pieces of video. Send them out to everyone. Aloha. Thank you.
Yeah.
Give me a morning with the rising sun so we can go out to play in the water. Flowers will lay before we jump out of bed and go on our way. We get down on our knees and pray in the water. Flowers will lay. Come, 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 come on.